talk to you about I Will Survive. How many of you can remember way back then? Give us a little taste of that, Cammie. Y'all know that. Y'all know that better than the worship song. I mean, come on. You're like, let's throw up our hands and worship Jesus. And it's all like, la, 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 la. And it's like, and then we play this. Go ahead, put it back on and look what y'all do. All right, so everybody say, I will survive. All right. All right, so let's figure out how we're going to survive, okay? In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, the word says, for God, the God who commanded the light to shine out of the darkness, the God who gave a command to the light to bring his brilliance into the earth, it gave its light, and it gave its light out of obscurity. It gave its light out of the unknown, and that God hath shined in your hearts. See, the God who spoke that powerful word that overcame the darkness is the one who you said yes to when you opened your heart to Jesus, and he lives inside of you, and now he speaks to your heart. Now, here's something I want you to think about. That term heart, when you look it up, it really means he speaks to you in your thoughts and in your feelings. Now, this is really important because God will speak to you through your spirit, but he's got to get to the man, so he's going to speak to your thoughts. Now, most people are afraid of their thought life because you've put too much nastiness in there for such a long time. There's a lot of nasty thoughts. But, you know, when you submit yourself to God and you allow Jesus to be Lord of your life, those nasty thoughts go away, or at least you're able to discern that's nasty now. You understand, at one point in your life, you just thought that was you. And so it was just normal nasty. That was probably your nickname, normal nasty. But now by the Spirit of God, you recognize that's not normal and I don't want to be nasty no more. So I have to direct my thoughts into righteousness. So you just change the channel now because you have the power to do it. But the same God who commanded light out of the darkness speaks to you today, and he does so in your thoughts and your feelings to give you illumination to the information of the glory of God. You see, God wants you to know what's going on in this generation, and he wants to fill your life, your thoughts. He wants to fill your feelings with such brilliance that there's nothing that's going to make you afraid, but you got to know where the source comes from. You're only going to find this in the face of Jesus. You don't find that watching the nightly news. You don't find that even in watching gospel shows. You don't find it by listening. You have faith will come to you, you know, when you hear the word of God or stuff of that nature. But there's something about when you look in the face of Jesus. You know, that's called intimacy. I love the fact that God is still in the business of speaking into my darkness. And here's the cool thing. And the darkness can't stop it. You see, what's going on in our generation today can't stop God, because he's God. The bad reports of this generation or anything that you're faced with today can't stop God from filling you with the information of the kingdom of God that gets you right through the darkness, takes you out of obscurity, takes you out of the unknown, and puts you right in the known, so then you can stand up in faith and say, not no more. I ain't taking this from you anymore. You can't lie to me no more. You can't steal from me anymore. I know that you're a thief. I know that you're a liar. And my father's not. So you got to go and he stays. That's what it means when he's my Lord. He stays. And so the one who spoke light be is the one who cascades light into you. And you have to embrace that, because here's the ultimate goal, that this brilliant light, the glorious knowledge of God, the information of God that you find in the face of Jesus, ultimately is going to be the face that this world looks at in you. So the first source of the knowledge of God will always be when I know Jesus, I look into his face and I get information. So he's speaking to me. But from a worldly standpoint, when I don't know Jesus, how does Jesus get to them? Through them looking at you, because you become the mirror. And until you understand the extraordinary blessing of God in your life, that when you walk into this world and you live by faith, you're not motivated by fear. You're not complaining anymore. How many of you know that your complaining is equivalent to your unbelief? So if you're a complainer, you're an unbeliever. You say, well, no, I'm a believer. Then why are you complaining? Those two things don't lock together. Stop the mess. You know, like just stop the mess. You have nothing to complain about. From the time you wake up in the morning, God's destiny lies before you. It's just in the face of Jesus, and you got to go get it. But once you get it and you walk out into the world, all those people who don't know where to get it, they see it in your face. So the first source of deliverance will always come personally in the face of Jesus, but secondly, in you. Do you know that you bring me hope today? Do you know that your attendance to this service puts fuel in my fire? I mean, your amens, your shouting, your praise not only moves God, but it moves everybody in this place. Do you know what's the difference between a service that's filled with glory and light? It's just the attendance and the awareness of the people. You want a rocking service that really exemplifies what Jesus is? Draw nigh to him and watch what happens. All right. So here's something to remember. Jesus, who took on the ruler of death, he annihilated all the effects of that accusing intimidation. That intimidating accuser has been stripped now. So that the work, the perfect word of God could be done, which was this, that he shines out of the darkness into your life. So out of your obscurity, today if you feel fearful, overwhelmed, you could have had a bad report, you know, it's just bad. Okay, I understand. And we're not making light of that. But I'm giving you the answer. The answer is that if you will bow your knee unto Jesus and you give time to his word and ask him by the presence of God, the Spirit of God, to direct you in the word for your answers, he's speaking out of your obscurity and he's speaking out of the unknown and he's giving you information. He said, I just don't know what to do. I understand that. I've been there before. But I just want to assure you this. He's always got an answer. He's always got an answer. So remember this, that Jesus, and I think we all understand this, he removed our sins. Why? To make us one with him. And he makes us holy by showing us his path in difficult times. Remember the word says that he's a light unto my feet. He gives light unto the path of my life. That is, if I don't need a light in the daytime, I need a light in difficult moments. And this generation is in a difficult moment right now. You're being bombarded all the time with bad news, fearful things, and we can't afford to live in that realm. We live above it, knowing this. I'm telling you, listen to me, and I'm not making light of this. If you don't have what it takes to pay your fuel bill, you have to believe that the word is more real than the report of what you see, and just go fishing. Go do something that you find your hands to do. Find out what God is saying to you in that dark moment and just do it. You say, well, all I feel like he tells me to do at this moment, I have a song to sing. Sing the song. It's the key. Say a word. Say the word. It's the key. You say, well, that doesn't make sense. It doesn't have to make sense. It just works. It takes faith to believe it. So let's look at something real quickly about the life of Paul. Now, Paul called this life, but in his life, he described his life serving God. And he says, so I've worked hard for God. And so you would consider that if I work hard for God, man, I'm going to walk in the manifold blessings of God. But he walked in some very difficult moments because he says, I've taken more beatings, dragged into prison, flogged extensively. 5 times I received 39 lashes. 3 times beaten with rods, stoned once, shipwrecked 3 times, spent an entire night and day adrift in the open ocean. I faced dangerous situations, perilous rivers, robbers, foreigners, and even of my own people. There were spies pretending to be believers. And he says, I was deprived of water, food, left hungry. I was shriveling in the cold. I lacked proper clothing. And then just on top of that, I had to carry the daily responsibility of all the churches. But I survived. I said, all of that, I survived. In other words, hey, there's a big old list of history of what this nation's been through, you've been through, every generation's been through. There's history, but we survived. And we come into this day. And there's a future before us. The question is, what kind of history will we write concerning the future? Because the world has, they have a tendency to know how to write history. And most of the times it's broken. But we know this prophetically through decades. The Lord has been revealing through his prophets. There's a move of God that is close and near. I believe every one of you can smell it in the air. Your heart feels that it's near. You don't know where it's at, but you know he's soon coming. And you have to live by faith in that. Because listen to me, when Jesus shows up in his fullness and glory, there is no place for darkness. So Romans chapter 8, verse 37, after Paul makes all these recognitions of all of his struggles, he says, I've survived, but I'm going to go above that. Nay, in all of these things. I said, in all of these things, I am more than a conqueror through him who loves me. I don't care what I'm faced with. I don't care what they say. I am more than a conqueror through him. It ain't because of me. It's because of who I'm attached to. It's who I walk with. So here's how we do it. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22, verse 25, all the way through there, verses 22 through 25, it says, so you and I are commanded to draw near with a sincere heart. Heart is defined the same way. With a sincere thought, sincere feelings of full assurance. Now that takes discipline. But there's a place, if you're called to do this, there's an anointing to get you there. That in your thoughts and in your feelings of life, out of your spirit, you walk in full assurance. The full assurance of faith. How? Because Jesus has now made your heart, your thoughts, your feelings, he has cleansed them from that evil conscience. Now, how many of you believe that that's true? The blood of Jesus has cleansed your inner world from the evil conscience that used to drive you. You're no longer that evil person that once used to be. Paul was an evil man before salvation, but then he became the great apostle that we all look to. So the blood cleanses him in his thought life. And your body is washed with pure water. So we can say then your feelings are also washed with pure water. So the Bible says, since now you are cleansed and washed, you should hold fast to the profession of your faith without wavering. Well, what is that? What is the profession of my faith? If we go all the way back to the first scripture, it is the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. You see, when God speaks into you and he gives you insight into his brilliance, that is the profession of your faith. Because you take that word, hide it in your heart, and you say it. One of our dear friends who's here is battling with an eye issue. So in his eye, he's experiencing this thing where it says it's like I'm looking through moss in my left eye. And the other day he spoke to me and he says, I'm believing that when I go see the physician, like Jesus did, when he told the man to wash his eye in the pool of Bethesda, that when that doctor sees this, he's going to wash that right out of my eye. And I'm like, brother, that is the word of your profession. In other words, don't just like sling that around. If God gave you revelation that when you visit the doctor, that doctor would have the availability to wash that blood out of your eye, then that's what you confess. Because remember, your evil conscience is gone, your body is washed, so now we are to hold fast to the profession of our faith without wavering. But every time I go on the TV set, they're telling me something different. You got to hold on. You've got to fight for this. That's why in many cases, just turn it off. It's not feeding you anything that you don't know or don't need to know. What are you getting? Daily updates or hourly updates on the same mess that's going on all the time. Just turn it off. I know that you feel like you're getting truth from Fox News. Turn it off. Your news source should be, thus saith the Lord. Now, I'm not opposed to watching the news. I want you to know that. But if you are being driven into fear and concern, overwhelm, turn it off. And hold fast to the confession of your faith without wavering. For he is faithful. He is faithful. He is faithful that has given you the light of the knowledge of the glory of God, who has given you the promise. And then verse 24 so says, all right, so this is just not about you now. So let us now consider one another, that we encourage one another unto love. We lead them to the one who's enthroned on love. We get them to stop looking at the bad reports, like I've had to learn how to stop doing these things, and I help them learn how to now look to the one enthroned on love. We provoke each other not unto wrath, but unto love and unto good works. Look at verse 25. And not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. Now, I want to share with you this. I believe for the most part that the church wants to be in harmony together and back together. But there's a fear that this generation has ushered into the human race. It's called COVID. And it's easier to be at home watching it on TV, which I'm not opposed to. But you cannot get away from that command. It's written. It's not for play. It's for your purpose, that none of us should forsake the assembling of ourselves together in the manner that some do, but we're to exhort one another in so much more as you see this evil day approaching. So the more you see it getting darker, the more you're behind supposed to be in that seat. You say, why? Because that's what he orchestrated for us. That's what he designed for us. You say, where do I find my hope? In the face of Jesus, but also in the face of each other. Amen. We bring each other hope. Amen. You encourage me just being here. Amen. And I hope by the fact that we're here, we encourage you. Amen. So we are to cling to the hope that God always keeps his promises, and I will survive. I said, I will survive. I will survive. Everybody say it, I will survive. I'm not bowing a knee to any inferior thoughts. I want you to see the next portion. This is why we make this statement. I will no longer bow my knee to inferior thoughts. I will not bow my knee to inferior forces. I will not bow my knee to inferior actions. I will only bow my knee to King Jesus. Because that system out there is trying to make you bow your knee in fear, telling you of a bad day yet to come. But Jesus has already told you there's a glorious day approaching. Oh, shout unto the Lord. with the voice of triumph. Now, to prove to you how important you are to the body of Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 18 says, but we all. Now, I want you to know something. This is huge. It doesn't say you. It says we all. We all with open face. In other words, Jesus, by his blood, removed the veil. He removed all counterfeits. There's no more counterfeit. You have the Spirit of God living in you. You're not a stepson or daughter. You're a child of the Most High God, and he does not withhold any good thing from you. I mean, if he gives you his Spirit, do you really think he's withholding anything from you? If he gave you his Son and gave you his Word, that he says, by no greater means could I make this thing official, I had to swear by myself. I had to take an oath, making sure you knew that if this was a lie, I ceased to exist. But he still reigns supreme. That we now have open face and we're able to see as in a glass or in a mirror. We're able to see the glory of the Lord, and as we do, are changed into the very same image. All right, you got to look at that. This is the power of the work of God on the inside of you, that the more you behold the glory of God, you are changed into the very same image that you see. Now listen, all right. Can we go down a little bit in the notes? We're going to go to where Rachel, she gave me these notes. I want you to see this. But it says, so what do you see? All right, what you see and believe is your truth. And what you see and believe is reality, is your reality, because you're looking in a mirror. And you're changed into the very image of whatever you're looking into. So that's why you got to be careful that in this generation at this time, that if you're looking into that system far too much, you become it. So whatever you believe is your truth and your reality, you think about it all the time. And what you think about, you talk about. And what you talk about authorizes what you believe, and its reality is soon coming to pass. It's coming to pass in your life, because there's life and death in the power of your tongue. And what you see and believe will manifest in your life. It's the process of dominion. All right, so let's go back to the scripture. But we, with open face, behold, we're able to see, as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, and we are changed into the very same image from brightness to brilliance, from beginning to end. Are we getting better and better? My better days are yet to come. I might be bright today, but you ain't seen nothing yet. Because the more I look into the face of Jesus, it just gets better. And you say, how's it done? By the Spirit of God. Now, what is the Spirit of God? It's the breath of God. The breath of God is when he speaks to you. All this is done in your fellowship with Jesus and the Word. Listen, church is not supposed to be just Sunday. Church is supposed to be every time you bring that Bible out and you open up, you should have church by yourself. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You begin to worship him. And now, I don't know where you all are, but in my life, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm not afraid of speaking out of my spirit. I read that word and go, oh, Rashi Teba. Yeah, I enjoy him. And if you've never experienced the baptism of the Holy Ghost and have that river flow out of you, you're missing something. There's fire in the belly. You say, well, I don't believe in that stuff. That's why you don't have it, because you look into your unbelief. All right. Whoa. So God's creative power that's in Christ Jesus removes the blindness of your heart, and he equips you to behold the glory, and now you reflect his brilliance. I want to end with this. When you understand this, you become a mirror of the glory of King Jesus. And we're looking to Jesus to bring his glory in, but he's saying that life shafts will flood the atmosphere that come from you. It'll drive out the darkness when you turn in to see or to behold his glory. His marvelous display of glory will be exhibited in you. Listen, I don't know how you view church, but there is something when the people of God come alive with worship and thanksgiving. They displace fear. They displace intimidation. They stand up with the joy of the Lord and they sing unto the Lord with a full heart. I'm telling you something, light shafts. You think Star Wars is something? Your praise is on another level. But you don't see it, so you just kind of go through the motions. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. But if you sing Donna something, hey, hey, I will survive. You come alive, man. Bring me back to my 80 days, boy. All right. So let's stand up.